السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على عبد الله ورسوله محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. We praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We send blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, all his companions, his entire household. May Allah bless them and bless every single one of us. Ameen. My brothers and sisters, as we know, there are 10 men who were told during their lifetime that they were from amongst those who would be in paradise. They were known as al-asharah al-mubashshirin bil jannah, the 10 who were granted the good news of paradise. So we have already covered four of them, being the four khalifs known as al-khulafa'ur rashidun, those who were the successors of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, one after the other, starting with Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiyallahu anhu, Umar al-Faruq radiyallahu anhu, Uthman ibn Affan known as Dhun-Nurayn radiyallahu anhu, and Ali ibn Abi Talib radiyallahu anhu. This evening we will be speaking about two more of these who made up the 10. The first being Talha ibn Ubaidillah radiyallahu anhu, and the second being Az-Zubayr ibn al-Awwam ibn Khuwaylid radiyallahu anhu. We ask Allah to grant us a good lesson. Who were these heroes of ours? What made it that they deserved Jannah? Or what did they do to make them deserve paradise? Talha ibn Ubaidillah was born approximately 15 years before the prophethood of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He was a man, as a young boy he grew up and he was extremely intelligent, from the noblemen of Quraysh, a beautiful family. Remember, those who said that only the weak and downtrodden were accepting Islam are wrong. All these names we are hearing, they were people who were noblemen in Quraysh. They came from top families, they were wealthy people, they were highly looked up to by Quraysh and the people of Quraysh. So Talha, as a young man, he used to go to the various regions or parts of the Arabian Peninsula for business. And one day he arrived in Ash-Sham, the northern part of the Arabian Peninsula, a place known as Busra. And he was with his caravan and with Quraysh, and they spent quite a bit of time there. And surprisingly, he heard one of the monks, one of the Christian monks, calling out, saying, "Those who have come from Mecca, is there anyone from the Haram itself? Is there anyone from amongst you who have come to do business from the Haram?" And Talha ibn Ubaidillah, as young as he was, he responded to this monk and he said, "You know what? Yes, I am one of them." He said, "I am one of them." So the monk says, "I have heard that at that particular place right now is the time for a prophet to come." Subhanallah. "So has this prophet come?" So Talha says, "I'm not sure." He says, "His name is Ahmad." Now Ahmad, as you know, the name of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has called him the same name in the Quran. So what has happened? Subhanallah. He said, "What is his full name?" This man says, "He is the son of Abdullah ibn Abdul Muttalib." Talha ibn Ubaidillah was shocked. He was surprised. He was amazed. And this monk had actually said, "He has come out in Mecca right now. And my little son, or you young man, do not let others beat you to him," meaning don't let them overtake you to accepting him. He is a truthful messenger. So Talha ibn Ubaidillah says, "As crucial as the business deals were, and as much as I wanted to make money, I decided to gather my camels and to start going back to Mecca." He says, "Very soon I arrived in Mecca." He was only a teenager. He arrived in Makkatul Mukarrama. And the first person he went to was Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiyallahu anhu, because they were related somehow. And at the same time, he chose to go to Abu Bakr because he knew Abu Bakr as a very good man. Abu Bakr was intelligent. He was a person who was easy to talk to. He was a very upright businessman. Everyone knew him as honest and he never lied. So he asked Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiyallahu anhu. He says, "Oh Abu Bakr, have you heard of this?" So Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu told him, "Yes, indeed, I've heard about it. And yes, indeed, I have followed him." Subhanallah. Now, just prior to him asking Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, when he arrived in Makkah and he met his family, he asked them a question. Has something big happened in Makkah whilst I was away? They told him, yes, that Muhammad ibn Abdullah has turned away from the religion of his forefathers. And that Muhammad ibn Abdullah is now claiming to be a person whom revelation comes to. And he says, you should worship your creator alone and forget about all these idols. So immediately Talha ibn Ubaidillah went to Abu Bakr as-Siddiq and the discussion occurred. So Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu told him, I have followed him. So Talha was shocked. He was surprised. He says, you know what? I want to tell you what happened when I went to Busra in Sham. Whilst I was on a business trip, one of the monks gave me this news. So Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu was so delighted. He said, let's go to Muhammad and let's tell him what you are saying. So Talha knew Ibn Ubaidillah in his heart that this has to be the truth, because Muhammad is known as As-Sadiqul Amin, the most truthful, the honest from amongst us. He cannot be now at the age of 40 lying to us when we've never ever known him to have lied a single lie regarding any one of us. Why would he lie about the Maker himself? So it was amazing that Talha ibn Ubaidillah, Allah put it in his heart. He went to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Muhammad ibn Abdullah told him, oh Talha, I am the messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I call you to discard and leave the religion of your forefathers, which is the worshipping of idols and the evil culture which oppresses women and which usurps the wealth of the stranger and so on. Quit all that and turn to Allah and Allah alone. Talha ibn Ubaidillah immediately accepted the message. He says, Ya Rasulullah, I bear witness that you are indeed the messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. None worthy of worship besides our Maker, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He was approximately the 8th person to accept Islam. Young boy, meaning in his teenage. Talha ibn Ubaidillah, sharp business person from his teen years. Amazing. So he got back to Makkah subhanallah and he told his people that he had accepted Islam. No sooner had they heard that he accepted Islam than they tried to harm him, and they started to harm him. He had a relative of his known as, in fact, his own mother. Her name was As-Sa'bah bint al-Hadrami. She was a very difficult woman. You know, the name is As-Sa'bah. Sa'bah in the Arabic language means one who is difficult. Now I want to pause there for a moment and encourage us all, when we are naming our children or our relatives, we should use good names. The name is so difficult itself. Imagine someone names you a difficult person. What do you expect to be thereafter? So this woman was called As-Sa'bah, the difficult one. She was hoping that Talha would be from amongst the leaders of Quraysh because he was intelligent and he was wealthy at a young age. So she had a lot of hope. But when he accepted Islam, she was so angry and so upset that she began not only to swear him and to use abusive words against him, but she told others to beat him up. So from amongst them was Nawfal ibn Khuwaylid. Nawfal ibn Khuwaylid was the brother of Khadija bint Khuwaylid radiallahu anha. He troubled Talha ibn Ubaidillah and a few of the early Muslims a lot. They were young, in his teen years. And so Nawfal tied him up, took with him Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu. They tied the two of them up and they took them to a certain place just on the outskirts of Makkah. And they made sure that all the youngsters happened to swear them, mock at them, throw things at them, and they beat them up. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala safeguard us. In fact, this Talha ibn Ubaidillah was harmed so much, they tied his hands behind his neck and they took him, pulled him, dragging him in a large group of people towards the Mount of Safa. And they started throwing stones at him and beating him and telling him that you'd better leave the religion of Muhammad. How dare you follow this faith? But he was so strong. He had heard in Busra what the monk had to say. And more than that, he was convinced by the message. All Muhammad is saying is, worship your Maker and your Maker alone. Don't worship anything else. Turn to your Maker. So he was convinced that this is correct, and he kept on sticking to his beliefs, and they kept on harming him. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala safeguard us all. He had heard also Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam read verses of the Quran, which had touched his heart. Talha ibn Ubaidillah was a person who stuck to his faith. And in fact, if we take a look at what happened later on when they were in the battle of Uhud, Talha ibn Ubaidillah was known for his bravery in the battle of Uhud. So much so that, do you know, whenever Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu spoke about the battle of Uhud, he said that was the battle of Talha ibn Ubaidillah. He was the hero of Uhud. Now, why do they know him as the hero of Uhud? Let me explain to you. Let's quickly go to the battle of Uhud, where, you know, initially the Muslimin were winning. And then when the archers decided to come down from the mount and disobey the instruction of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, the disbelievers of Mecca happened to come back and attack. And they swiped the Muslimin in a way that many people had suffered, so much so that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam's teeth were martyred. And at the same time, he had a gash on his lip and a gash on his forehead, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And he was lying down in Uhud. He was sitting down at one place where the mount, or in one of the parts of the mount, and a whole group of enemies had come to attack him. And around him were a few of the Ansar and Talha ibn Ubaidillah. Very few men. And there were so many mushrikeen who had come. So Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam asked his companions, who would take care of these mushrikeen? So Talha said, I will. He said, no, you sit down. So the Ansar one by one went, and each one of them were martyred, until there was only Talha and Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam remaining. And a group of the mushrikeen started coming very close. Talha ibn Ubaidillah got up and he really fought these people so much. He did not allow them to get close to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. They say he suffered more than 70 wounds on his body, protecting Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And he chased away those mushrikeen in a battle that was just between him and a whole group of mushrikeen on the day of Uhud. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala safeguarded him and safeguarded Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. On that day, he lost his palm. The palm of one of his hands was martyred as well on that particular day. He lost it. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant him goodness. So much so that Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu and Abu Ubaidah Amir ibn al-Jarrahi radiallahu anhu, they happened to rush towards Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam when they saw him in blood. And they asked him, O Messenger, are you okay? He said, don't worry about me. Go and see your companion Talha ibn Ubaidillah. He was laying on the floor in a pool of blood with so many gashes that he had. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all goodness and a lesson to learn from this. So Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam used to call him Ash-Shaheedul Hayy, the martyr who is alive. Allahu Akbar. And he was the one whom the day of Uhud belonged to, according to a lot of the companions of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So this was the man Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam told him, Talha, you are from amongst those who have already earned paradise. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Look at him. So what he lost, listen to this carefully, what he lost in terms of his business deals when he had just accepted Islam, and what he lost in terms of the respect amongst the disbelievers of Quraysh, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him so much in return. It was multiplied so much, and he had such a big heart. He was one of those, just like Uthman ibn Affan. Some say that he was even more generous because he gave a lot. Like we said, quantity wise, no one competes with Uthman. But when you look at percentage wise, there were a lot who actually had given so much. Even what they would have for themselves, they would give it away to others. One of those was Talha ibn Ubaidillah. Let me give you an example. One of the days, this man, one of his caravans had just come in from Hadramaut in the evening, and he had stock worth 700,000 dirhams. Stock worth 700,000 dirhams. And in the evening he was worried, and he was sitting on his bed and he could not sleep. So his wife, who was the daughter of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anh, by the name of Kulthum bint Abi Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anha, she told him, oh my beloved husband, have I done something to hurt you? You are looking quite worried today. So he looked at her and said, you are such a great woman. You see me concerned and you actually think that you are the one who has made me worried. Imagine when our wives sometimes see us worried, I wonder if they would actually come to us and tell us, is it me who's done something to you? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us husbands who are concerned even of their own wives. When we see them worried, it is important for us to ask them, I hope it's nothing I have done that has made you so worried. We learn it from here. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us the best of spouses. Ameen. So, and may Allah bless those who are not married with spouses who will be the coolness of their eyes. Oh, look at that loud ameen, mashallah. May Allah grant it to us all, ameen. So this was the daughter of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu. So she looked at him, he said, not at all. She says, well then I think I know what is bothering you. You have so much wealth here in your home. So much wealth here in your home. Subhanallah. And you are perhaps worried. What are you going to answer Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when there are people outside who are poor and who are beggars? He said, yes, exactly. So she said, why don't you just distribute this wealth? He said, no problem. They started making little packs. They started making portions. And in the morning, they called out there in Medina Munawwara and they gave out all that to those who were poor amongst the Muslimin in Makkah, in Medina Munawwara. 700,000 silver coins worth of stock, everything given. This was the man, Talha ibn Ubaidillah. He was also a man whom once someone came to him who was needy and told him, do you know what, O Talha, you are a person who looks after all your relatives, because he made sure that everyone from his relation and his family were all taken care of. He was a person who used to look after the whole of Banu Taym. Anyone from Banu Taym, poor, Talha ibn Ubaidillah would spend on them and he would provide for them food and whatever else they needed, them and their families. And even the others from amongst the Muslimin. So one man came to him and told him, I'm related to you in this way and this way and this way and this way, and you know I need your help. So he looked at him, he says, I don't know about this relation. Nobody's told me about it before, but I offer you a piece of land that Uthman ibn Affan has offered me 300,000 for. You either take the land or I can sell it to Uthman and give you the money. He looked at Talha and he says, okay, I'll take the money. Talha ibn Ubaidillah went to Uthman, sold the piece of land, took the money and gave this person who was claiming to be a relative. This was the type of heart he had. Imagine 300,000 all at once given to one man who came to him with a story. And he was not worried. He said, Allah will provide. And guess what? The more he gave, the more he got. Allahu Akbar. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us and grant us goodness. Sadly and unfortunately, he was from amongst those who was killed during the battle of Jamal, or the battle of the camel, the fitna between the Muslimin. And do you know what happened? They had come out and they went to Basra, which is in Iraq, in order to meet with Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu to try and get those who had killed Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu anhu. But they did not mean to kill one another. No, not at all. And this is why it is reported in the correct narrations that Talha ibn Ubaidillah and Zubayr ibn al-Awwam, they withdrew when they saw Ali and when they spoke to Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu, and they did not want a war, but sadly some people killed them. So Talha ibn Ubaidillah, there are some narrations which say that Marwan ibn al-Hakam actually killed him, but the most correct of narrations say no, it was not Marwan ibn al-Hakam, it was someone else who actually killed him on that day with one spear. And when Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu saw what happened, he began to weep, he cried so much, and he actually made so much of dua for Talha ibn Ubaidillah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all a good lesson. Remember, I told you and I'm repeating it, be careful of those who try to instill hatred in your heart against your fellow brethren. They did this from the beginning and they succeeded in splitting the Muslimin and making them fight with one another. Up to this day, they are doing the same. Let them not succeed in this way. If we don't learn a lesson from this, why then do we go through these stories? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness. So Talha ibn Ubaidillah, one of the 10, and he was from amongst those whom Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu had named to be from the committee who would appoint a successor, later appointing Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu anhu. Our next hero for this evening, Az-Zubayr ibn al-Awwam. Az-Zubayr ibn al-Awwam ibn Khuwaylid radiallahu anhu. Why do I say ibn Khuwaylid? Because it's important for us to know the wife of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Her name was Khadija binti Khuwaylid. And this man was Az-Zubayr ibn al-Awwam ibn Khuwaylid, which means al-Awwam was the brother of Khadija. So Az-Zubayr was the nephew of Khadija. But at the same time, his mother was Safiya bint Abd al-Muttalib. She was the aunt of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, making Az-Zubayr the first cousin of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Subhanallah. So he was related to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam very closely as a first cousin, and also to Khadija bint Khuwaylid radiyallahu anha as a nephew. This was his relation, Az-Zubayr ibn al-Awwam. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, all messengers have disciples, and Az-Zubayr is one of my disciples. Subhanallah. He was known as Hawariyu Rasulillahi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. A powerful man, a really good person from amongst those who were noble people of Quraysh. I've already told you his lineage. He was the seventh to accept Islam. He was an orphan as well. His father was killed in a battle, one of those battles of the period of ignorance, just like his grandfather had been killed before, and his name was Khuwaylid, that was the grandfather. So they were all killed in these little battles that took place for petty reasons prior to Islam. Az-Zubayr ibn al-Awwam, he accepted Islam the next day after Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, or the following day. Very close, and his age was only 15 years. He had an uncle called Nawfal. Nawfal ibn Khuwaylid was the man whom, when Safiya bint Abd al-Muttalib used to admonish and discipline her own son who was an orphan, then Nawfal used to say, oh Safiya, you're being too hard on this child. Why are you beating him up? So she used to say, I'm beating him up in order to discipline him. I want him to grow up. He has no father. I'd like him to grow up with great character and conduct so he can be a brave man. So Nawfal used to take the side of the little child and always say, you being a little bit too hard on the child. But all that changed the minute Az-Zubayr ibn al-Awwam announced that I'm a follower of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. 15 years old, what would he know? But he was a person who had understood that it is my duty to find out what is right and wrong. Islam is the truth. The same Nawfal began to harm him. So much so that Nawfal used to take these little mats and tie them around Az-Zubayr ibn al-Awwam and start burning the end of the mat. And when the fire used to burn him, he used to say, just say you're no longer with Muhammad. He would say, no ways, I'm not going to say that. You can burn me, do what you want. And as the fire would come close to his toes, he would then release him from the mat. This was Az-Zubayr ibn al-Awwam ibn Khuwaylid radiyallahu anhu. So what happened? Because of all this harassment of Quraysh, Az-Zubayr ibn al-Awwam was one of those who rushed to Abyssinia, to Africa, as the first of the migrators. And he was the youngest of the lot, according to some narrations. Something interesting happened in Abyssinia with Az-Zubayr ibn al-Awwam. An-Najashi, the Negus of Abyssinia, who was the ruler, there was someone who had come to fight him with an army in order to try to overthrow him. So the Muslims were worried and they were making dua for An-Najashi, because they knew he was the one who gave them respite and he offered them a place to live. And if he has to be overthrown, there's going to be a problem for the Muslims. So An-Najashi happened to cross the Nile at one place and he was fighting the person who came to overthrow him. And the Muslims were on the other side making dua. So the Muslims gathered and said, you know what? We need someone to actually go across this Nile. And it was at a point where it was quite long to cross. And we need to find out the story, who is winning, so that we know what to do here. Because if the others win, we have to prepare to start leaving and we have to look at another plan. So Az-Zubayr ibn al-Awwam was the youngest of the lot. He says, I will swim across. Amazing. So what did they do? They gave him what we would term today a life vest. But what was the life vest made of? Nothing fancy. They took one of the drinking skins that they used to keep water in, and obviously it is airtight. They filled it with air. They blocked it, sealed it, and they tied it on his chest. They told him, right, you may go. So he tied it on his chest and he went through across the Nile, right to the other side, swimming as a little boy. And he continued, and when he went there, he witnessed the war, the battle. He noticed that now An-Najashi has won, and he quickly swam back. The Muslims were waiting for him. He came back and told them, I have good news for you, An-Najashi has won. This was the bravery of the youngster, subhanallah, swimming across the Nile. Just with a little, inflated piece of material. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness. May He make us good swimmers. Remember, it is a sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to learn how to swim and to master it. But one quick point, make sure you're dressed appropriately when you are swimming. Alhamdulillah. My brothers and sisters, this was Az-Zubayr ibn al-Awwam radiyallahu anhu. When he came back from Abyssinia, there was a rumor that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was taken by the kuffar of Quraysh in order to be killed. Az-Zubayr ibn al-Awwam was young. He took his sword out and he marched through the leaders of Quraysh in order to go and look for Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and found him on the outskirts of Makkah. And Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saw the first Muslim ever to hold a sword in his hand as though he is at war. And he looked at him and says, Az-Zubayr, what is wrong? Az-Zubayr says, O messenger, I heard that they wanted to kill you, so I just came to make sure that you're okay. And this was the first sword that was ever drawn by a Muslim. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us a lesson. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made dua for him, prayed for him and for his bravery. He was a very, very brave man. Az-Zubayr ibn al-Awwam radiyallahu anhu, he was one of the three people whom at the time of his own hijrah to Medina, he made an announcement just like Umar ibn al-Khattab. He got up at al-Maqam and he made the tawaf and he says, Oh Quraysh, I am leaving for hijrah. Let's see what you're going to do. Anyone who wants to harm me, we'll see you on the other side. This was said by three people: Umar ibn al-Khattab, Hamza ibn Abdul Muttalib, and Az-Zubayr ibn al-Awwam ibn Khuwaylid radiyallahu anhum jami'an. May Allah's peace and blessings be upon all of them. These three were the bravest of the lot. They told their relatives and Quraysh, now let's see what you want to do. We are leaving. You dare try and follow us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us at least a little bit of bravery. When I say a little bit of bravery, a mosquito comes to my mind. Because sometimes we see our own children looking at a mosquito and they're so frightened, they don't even know what to do. Subhanallah. Like they say, to swat a fly. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it easy for us. There are beautiful butterflies that I notice in this masjid. They are not here to scare you, my brothers and sisters. They are here to beautify the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, amazingly, this man at the Battle of Badr, Az-Zubayr ibn al-Awwam, he was given one of the two horses that they were. They were two stallions. Az-Zubayr ibn al-Awwam was on one of them. And believe me, he was one of the warriors. He was one of the best of the lot during the Battle of Badr. Then at the Battle of Badr, something unique happened. Az-Zubayr ibn al-Awwam was wearing a yellow turban. And Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saw thousands of yellow turbans. And he looked at his companions. He said, the angels have just come down and they're all dressed like Az-Zubayr ibn al-Awwam. Subhanallah. Az-Zubayr ibn al-Awwam ibn Khuwaylid, one of the 10 who was told, you are from amongst those who are already guaranteed a place in paradise. And as for Uhud, there were people that were attacking the Muslimin. One man in particular was attacking the Muslims. And Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saw him one after the other. He was attacking the Muslims one after the other. And Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam looks at Az-Zubayr ibn al-Awwam and told him, Oh Zubayr, tackle this man. So Zubayr ibn al-Awwam went through and overcame him in a very short time. This was Az-Zubayr ibn al-Awwam. In the battle of Hunayn, he was such a brave warrior that the mushrikeen, the enemy, they had a meeting amongst them. Who is this man who is so brave that he comes all the way through our lines and he's not even worried? They said, this is Az-Zubayr ibn al-Awwam. You'd better be careful. This man is fearless. He worries nobody. He fears no one besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Even the mushriks and the enemies learned a lesson from this man. Then when it came to the conquest of Egypt, at the time of Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, Amr ibn al-As radiallahu anhu had asked for some help. So Umar al-Khattab radiallahu anhu decided to send 4 men with 4,000 men. Who were these 4 leaders? One of them was Az-Zubayr ibn al-Awwam. The other was Ubadat ibn al-Samit, al-Miqdad ibn al-Aswad, and Maslamah ibn Mukhallad radiyallahu anhum. May Allah's peace and blessings be upon them all. And Umar ibn al-Khattab wrote to Amr ibn al-As saying, Oh Amr, I'm sending you 4,000 men. And at the top of each 1,000 is a man who is worth 1,000 himself, which makes them 8,000. Subhanallah. Az-Zubayr ibn al-Awwam, he was instrumental in the conquest of Egypt. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness. He was married to another daughter of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiyallahu anhu, the famous Asma'a binti Abi Bakr radiyallahu anha. Amazing. So himself, meaning Az-Zubayr ibn al-Awwam, Talha ibn Ubaidillah married to another sister, and Muhammad ibn Abdullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam married to another sister known as Aisha binti Abi Bakr. These three were related in many ways. Can you see? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness. He was a person who had several wives and many children. From amongst his children, the most noteworthy, they were all noteworthy, but those who were at the top, Abdullah ibn Zubayr radiallahu anhu. Abdullah ibn Zubayr was one of the Amir al-Mu'mineen after Ali ibn Abi Talib, and after some time, for a very short period of time. And another of his children, Urwah ibn Zubayr. Remember, Aisha radiallahu anha was related to them, Urwah ibn Zubayr and Abdullah ibn Zubayr and the children of Zubayr, because she was the aunt, the mother's sister. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us an understanding of these relations. This is why she would travel with her nephews. People wondered, why is she traveling? But that was the real aunt, first aunt. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us all. How was this man killed? Amr ibn al-As. Amr ibn al-As was the man who was in Egypt. But this Az-Zubayr ibn al-Awwam radiyallahu anhu, Az-Zubayr ibn al-Awwam ibn Khuwaylid, he died with Talha ibn Ubaidillah during the same fitna, the same problem that occurred, the battle of the camel between the Muslims, amongst them, themselves. Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu on one side and some of the other companions on the other. They had not come to kill each other, but there were enemies on either side who wanted to see them fighting. And they kept on kindling the flame, and they kept on making them want to fight each other, until, as I said, Az-Zubayr ibn al-Awwam and Talha ibn Ubaidillah, they were of similar age, they had similar qualities, they had served Islam in a great way, in a similar way. They both withdrew from the battle, but Talha ibn Ubaidillah was killed. And as for Az-Zubayr ibn al-Awwam, he was killed by a man known as Amr ibn Jurmuz. And believe me, Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu screamed when he found out about the death of Az-Zubayr ibn al-Awwam. Although he was on the other side, like I said, they did not come to kill one another. But there were enemies who wanted to see them fight one another. And when the man who had martyred Az-Zubayr ibn al-Awwam wanted to enter to meet Ali, Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu refused. He said, I don't want to see this man. And when the sword was brought, that was the first sword that was used to protect Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Ali ibn Abi Talib, he knew the story. He was there when it happened. He began to cry and he wept so much. And then he said, I have hope in my heart and I know that Allah will gather myself. Meaning Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu, Talha ibn Ubaidillah, Az-Zubayr ibn al-Awwam and Uthman ibn Affan in paradise. And we will be together. Subhanallah. And then he recited the verses of the Quran where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَنَزَعْنَا مَا فِي صُدُورِهِمْ مِنْ غِلٍّ إِخْوَانًا عَلَى سُرُرٍ مُتَقَابِلِينَ. Allah speaks of paradise. We have removed from their hearts that ill feeling they had for one another. Now they are on beddings, lying, facing one another as brothers. This is in paradise. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us entry into paradise. The year 36 Hijri saw the battle of the camel, where some of the companions had lost their lives. From amongst them were the two heroes we spoke about today, Talha ibn Ubaidillah and Az-Zubayr ibn al-Awwam ibn Khuwaylid radiyallahu anhum. May Allah be pleased with them and may He be pleased with us all. Wa sallallahu wa sallama wa baraka ala nabina Muhammad. Subhanallahu bihamdih. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdika. Nashhadu an la ilaha illa ant. Nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk.